This is The Orange Couch.
I'm Mark.
I'm Amanda.
And this is Mad Men, Season 5, Episode 9, Dark Shadows.
Hello, Mr. Collins.
Miss Winters.
Vicky. Mr. Collins is going to move into the old house.
You mean you actually want to live there?
Yes, live. That's exactly what I intend to do.
Barnabas Collins was the odd but charming stranger on the TV show Dark Shadows. He came onto the show during its second season and is really kind of credited with reviving the show, really giving it life.
Like Dark Shadows, Sterling Cooper Draper Price spent a whole season trying to follow the old script and how everybody else had kind of done it before, but Michael's here to innovate in season two.
So really, this is like Michael as Barnabas Collins, I think, in this episode. This isn't the first time he's been compared to a pop culture icon of a powerful outsider. In Faraway Places, he tells a story about being an orphan alien that obviously owes a lot to the Superman story.
And of all the shots we get of the Macy's Day Parade, what do we see in the sky but a big balloon of Superman?
So sharp, it could only come...
I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that Jane is actually watching Dark Shadows there.
That would make a lot of sense. She's watching the show in the middle of the afternoon when soap operas played, and while Dark Shadows was a show about vampires and ghosts, at its heart it was a soap opera.
This episode actually drew a lot on the themes that soap operas play with.
And if there's one act soap opera writers love, it's sabotage. Three different characters attempt soap opera-style undermining in this episode. We already saw Michael's name on all the work in the office, and for the first time, we saw Don clocking in extra hours just to compete with Michael.
And Michael calls him out on it.
No, it's just damn impressive you could not write for so long and come back with that. It's good to know.
Thank you.
Don's doing all of this out of insecurity, and when his idea comes in a close second, he literally leaves Michael's behind. Then he's all, whatever.
I feel bad for you.
I don't think about you at all.
Liar!
Obviously, Michael got to him, so that's gotta be a lie. And he also lies about the sale being the only thing that matters. If that were true, he could have just taken Michael's idea to the sale instead of his.
Verdict on the sabotage?
Successful. For now.
The second intentional attempt at sabotage is Betty's.
You know what? Don't forget your daddy's first wife.
You're right here, Elizabeth Hosted Francis.
No, your father had another wife before me.
Megan once again shows she's a master of human motivation, and she's the one who sniffs it out.
You think this is an accident? If you call her, you're giving her exactly what she wanted. The thrill of having poisoned us from 50 miles away.
Verdict on this sabotage.
Let's go to Sally.
Daddy showed me pictures, and they spoke very fondly of her.
The third sabotage is subconscious.
I told you why I wanted this apartment and you ignored me.
Roger really has thought he's in control of his life since the LSD incident.
And yet he can't stop himself from mucking up Jane's attempt to make a clean break.
So, verdict on this sabotage?
As cloudy as a smog emergency in Midtown.
Having watched a bunch of Dark Shadows over the last week, we noticed how rarely characters actually say what they think in soap operas. In contrast, on Mad Men, some characters experimented with saying what they really think.
You know what, Howard? Why don't you spend Thanksgiving with her, and I'll go to your house and screw your wife.
If only Howard believed him.
Sally plays it fake crying before she gets real with Megan after learning about Anna.
Sally's real talk led to Don and Megan learning that this secret wasn't that big a deal at all.
And because Megan spoke directly with Don about the problem, who in turn spoke mostly real with Sally, the whole soap opera drama was diffused.
Betty's the one losing weight, but it's Don and Megan with the real weight off their shoulders.
Now, outside of all of the drama-rama, the soap opera-style shenanigans, we're wondering what is up with Peggy.
And we're not alone.
Peggy really got buried with Hines.
So, like, every other scene of Peggy this season is her at her desk late at night drinking and typing.
Type, 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 type. She is gone so often that Abe can't shut up about it, and yet she doesn't seem to be getting any work done, or at least any work that anybody else is seeing.
Speculation time?
Does Peggy have something going on outside of the grind of Sterling Cooper Draper Price?
She does think it's cool that Megan left the job to go get a career in acting. Did she get hit by the playwriting bug?
And, you know, she was awfully supportive of Ken's secret writing career. Maybe she's drawing up the next great American novel. There were all of these shots of Don and Megan in season 4 that totally seemed like background. I wonder if all of this setup around Peggy, all of the environments that we're seeing her in, all of the sort of activities she's doing without anybody directing any actual dialogue towards it, is suggesting that we're heading for a big breakthrough for Peggy.
She certainly was cooler than Dawn about her ideas being trumped by Michael.
Next week brings down the curtains on 1966. Maybe 1967 will have Peggy's big break.
We'll be holding our breath right here on the Orange Couch.